Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking to people of the book who know that the Prophet has been told about in their own books. So this final messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is foretold in their own books. And Allah is testifying to that in this ayah. That part of the ayah I'll skip through. But I'll tell you the part of the ayah that describes the messenger's role sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهُمُ الْخَبَائِفِ. He commands them to good things. He forbids them from evil things. He opens the doors for them. He makes permissible for them good and pure things. And He makes impermissible for them filthy things. This is one of the central roles of a messenger of Allah, and this final messenger of Allah, that He will tell us to do good things, keep us away from bad things, open the door to pure things for us, and close the door from filthy things away from us. So we stay away from the filthy things. But then Allah mentions something very powerful. وَيَضَعَ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالِ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. And to remove from them, listen to this part carefully, to remove from them the burdens. Isr is a heavy burden. It also actually means an agreement. So combining the two meanings, it actually means a very heavy agreement, a loaded agreement. He came to remove that burden from them, and al-aghlal, al-aghlal al-tawq, yuj'al fil yad, you know, the chains that are put in the hands, or around the neck. You know, what kind of person has those kinds of chains? You know, right? A prisoner. A prisoner has chains around his hands and chains around his neck. Allah says this messenger came to remove people of burdens, and the chains that were around their hands and necks that they were enslaved by, He came to remove them. What chains are these? As society goes forward, the only thing, even in a Muslim society, of course the first thing we're concerned about, like the first generation, the only thing on their minds was, what is permissible, what is not permissible? What is it that we have to do, and what is it that we have to forbid? That was their primary concern. Nothing else mattered, everything else was secondary. But as time goes on in an ummah, society and its pressure starts mixing in. So you don't just have the obligation to abide by what Allah says, now you also have the obligation to abide by what society says. You've got additional chains, you've got additional burdens. And the messenger comes to let go of those burdens. We think we follow societal pressure because it'll make life easy. It does nothing but make life harder. A lot of times when people follow a particular tradition, and I'll give you an example closer to home, I'm from Pakistan originally, and this is a problem in Pakistan, I'll tell you. We have to have the most lavish kinds of weddings. We have the most exotic, the most over-the-top, super expensive kinds of weddings. Even if the family can't afford it. Even if they can't afford it, they have to have that kind of wedding. And if you ask the family, why are you doing this? Why are you putting yourself in thousands of dollars of credit card debt? Why are you doing that? They say, well, your cousin had a wedding like that. What are we going to show? How are we going to show our face to your uncle? Or this friend of yours got married. They had a big wedding. How are we going to just have a nikah at the masjid? What are you, crazy? What are we have to show our face in society. It's not because the deen says you should go over the top. It's what? Society. Society. And so they'll put themselves in all kinds of financial trouble. And imagine a young man and woman who are just getting married, and it'll be lucky if they're young, because if they're from the countries we come from, they don't let them get them married until they're like 30 or something. But if they are young and they get married, they're just starting out, and they start their life with debt. They start their married life with this huge burden on them because of this insane party that no one remembers 3 days later. For nothing else. Just to fulfill a societal urge, this pressure that somebody felt. No other reason. What are people going to say? In Urdu, they say, "Log kya kahenge?" Right? What are people going to say if we don't do this? So much concern about what people might say. And it leads you into your deeper troubles for yourself. On the other hand, Allah says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ. Allah just wants to lighten your burden. Allah wants to take the load off of you. That's what the deen is supposed to be. And you'll find people that are enslaved to their culture, they're enslaved to their societal pressure. When they talk about Islam, they say Islam is tough. Islam is too strict. That's exactly what these people say. Islam is too strict. And what's funny is, if they followed even small principles of the deen, their life would be a lot easier. The deen would make their life easier, not harder. And what they're trying to follow only lands them in deeper and deeper and deeper trouble. That's what it lands them into. But they don't realize it. A messenger comes to remove these burdens. But there's another meaning of these burdens also and these chains. You know, when we follow a certain way in our life, our children learn from us. Just like our parents learn from their parents. And it's passed down. So when we stand in front of Allah on Judgment Day and we have generations of people who disobeyed Allah because of societal pressure, we're chained to them. We're tied to them. Their burden is our burden because we set that trend. We set that precedent for them. We have to answer for what they've done also. They have to answer for themselves and we on top of that. SubhanAllah. It's a serious problem. This is why Ibrahim alayhi salam, as an intelligent father, makes the dua, waj'alna, or actually we are taught to make the dua, waj'alna lilmuttaqina imama. Right? Make us imam over al-muttaqin in Surah Al-Furqan. Because on Judgment Day, we don't want to be tied to people that went down the wrong path. They're going to drag us down with them. Now I want to take you to the ayat that this khutbah is actually about. This is from Surah Al-Baqarah. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, towards the second half of this surah, one of the main conversations is what people follow. What people follow. Who they end up following. And why they follow who they follow. Now this particular passage that I chose has to do with the Day of Judgment. And on Judgment Day, everybody stands up, and I want you to think of it this way. There are trendsetters, and there are trend followers. You followed someone when you did something. You dressed a certain way. You walked a certain walk. You talked a certain talk. You bought a certain kind of car. You moved to a certain kind of neighborhood. You hung out with a certain kind of posse. These were your trendsetters. You were around them. Most of what you did was influenced by them. These are your trendsetters. This ayah is about them. These trendsetters. These are the people that people like to follow. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا. When those who used to be followed, these are trendsetters. When they will be cutting themselves off, disassociating themselves from all those who used to follow them. So here you are, you made your life miserable trying to be like someone, trying to fit in with a certain crowd, worried about what they're going to think of you, how acceptable you'll be to them. Judgment Day comes around and the first thing these trendsetters do, these leaders do, is they say, I have nothing to do with you. Why are you trying to be like me? I want nothing to do with you. تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا. I got nothing to do with you. And you'll be like, wait, you're the one who told me, don't rent an apartment, go get into a house. You're the one who said, you have to be smart, go get into a mortgage. Don't worry about halal, haram, just do it. And I listened to you and everybody around you, you guys are the ones who got me into this. You're the one who told me this is a good business idea. Yeah, it's got liquor too, but it's okay. Don't worry about it. Ramadan's around the corner, you can make extra salawat, you'll be alright. It'll clean it all up. Don't worry about it, it's a good business, I'm telling you, a lot of money in it. And I went into this business because I listened to you. I got into it because of you. You know, you have certain circles in the Muslim community. I won't even talk about outside Muslim community, that's inside Muslim community. You have certain circles, you have the business circle, you have the professional circles, you have the physician circles. And in each circle there are certain standards, right? There are certain kinds of parties they like to throw. Or there are certain kinds of gatherings they like to have. And each one tries to outdo the other to keep up with the circle. They make each other, they feed each other in their wrongdoing. And now they're cutting off from each other on Judgment Day. I want nothing to do with you. All that stuff you did is your problem, not my problem. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا وَرَأَوُ الْعَذَابِ. They will all be, Allah makes the jam'ah which combines everybody. The followers and the leaders are all looking at the punishment. وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابِ. And all relationships at that point are cut. You don't care about no society, what nobody else thinks then, it's all gone. All zero. All of that stuff that we were so worried about here, completely erased. And now the people who mindlessly followed. And before I talk about mindlessly following, I have to interject. On our flight here from Dallas, I flew with my family to California maybe about 10 days ago. So we're all the kids were asleep. And so my wife and I were the only ones awake. And you know how they dropped the TV screen? So thankfully the children were all asleep. So we're the only ones, even if you don't want to, it's right in your face, the TV screen, right? And we don't have headphones, so it's a silent film for us. You know what it was? It was the Justin Bieber documentary. So we watched the Justin Bieber doc. It was torture. It was like an hour and a half of Justin Bieber in your face. But wallahi, it was an educational experience.